with that crossing, unless you're familiar with it, I think it needs to be highlighted more.
Coming up a hill.
Because you're coming up a hill, and there's on both sides, you're coming up a hill. And by the time you get up there, if you're not doing the speed limit, you're going to have a very hard time stopping. It's been a problem. It needs to be fixed. More awareness. I don't know how you do it.
I think it needs flashing lights.
Yeah, flashing lights would be a great addition.
That's a golfer in Louisville describing a really bad problem. Because there was a golfer in a golf cart, father of three, who was crossing, struck by a car, killed. And now we've got a murder trial on our hands. Let's bring in Court TV legal correspondent Chanley Painter, who joins us tonight. Chanley, let me ask you a little bit about this defendant. I think we could put his picture up right now. Lazaro Pozo Ilias. He's been charged with murder in this case. Give us the details. How do you go from a car striking a golf cart to a murder charge?
Well, the prosecution here alleges that he was speeding twice the speed limit, Vinny, and intoxicated twice the limit at the time that this happened, around 4 o'clock on August 11, 2019. Now, based on court documents, the prosecution alleges that the defendant was at a cookout in the early afternoon of that day. He told authorities he drank an entire bottle of Hennessy. Vinny, he wanted to go get some more alcohol at the liquor store. He hopped in his friend's red Mustang, took two of his friends with him, picked up some more alcohol at the store. On the way back to the cookout, that is when the unfortunate incident happened. He was, again, speeding through this public golf course, disregarded, according to prosecutors, the warnings and the crosswalk. In fact, the golf cart was 2 seconds into the crosswalk, according to the court documents, before they were hit and, again, killing at 45-year-old Christopher Schultz, like you said, was a father of three young kids, a highly regarded community member there. He was a coach at the local Catholic school, and he started a couple of mentoring programs, very active there. It was an intense loss for this community at the time.
Absolutely. And, you know, we see this in neighborhoods across America, but this road, double yellow lines, I'm looking at it, I could see some people speeding through there and it being a problem. But this guy, a bottle of Hennessy, and there's two other people with him. What do we know here about what the defense is alleging? I mean, is there a defense here?
Well, the defense isn't saying whether or not they will put on a case. Court TV, of course, reached out to the defense attorneys. He's being represented by the public defender's office there in Kentucky. But based on some of the court documents, Vinny, they're contesting some of the key issues. They're contesting whether or not he was actually speeding, whether or not he was actually intoxicated, and, of course, trying to raise some doubt with the prosecution's experts. There was a ruling by the judge denying, of course, this motion, but we expect the prosecution to bring in an expert to talk about the alcohol elimination rates over time. It'll be interesting to see what the defense does at this point, but they aren't saying as of right now.
All right, so what are the official charges?
The official charges, of course, murder for the death of 45-year-old Christopher Schultz there. That's charged as intentional or as this reckless disregard for human life under extreme indifference, if you will. Also, first-degree assault. That's the driver of the golf cart, Brian Hovkamp. He was seriously injured during this wreck, and so he's charged with first-degree assault for that victim. We expect Brian Vinny to testify, of course, in this case against the defendant. There's also two counts of first-degree wanton endangerment. That is for the two passengers inside the red Mustang the defendant was driving at the time, because he put their lives in danger as well. Also, operating a motor vehicle under the influence of intoxicants, and he did not have a driver's license at the time.
Oh, across the board, a major problem. So, when does everything start?
It starts tomorrow with jury selection in Louisville, Kentucky, and we expect openings to begin on Wednesday. The prosecution telling Court TV they expect their case in chief to last about a week, Vinny.
All right, Chanley Painter, Court TV legal correspondent, thank you so much. Let's bring back in our think tank tonight and see what they have to say about this. And Gerald Griggs, I'm looking at this case, and I don't think he did it on purpose, but when does an accident become a murder case?
And that's a good question. You know, in Georgia, it would be vehicular homicide. I'm concerned whether or not In Kentucky, they have first-degree murder because how do you prove the malice with the forethought? So it's kind of curious that they would go for the top count of murder. But again, based on the circumstances, the speeding, the reckless conduct, the consumption of alcohol, I could see a vehicular homicide case being made here, but I'm kind of concerned about a murder charge. It seems like it's overreaching a little bit.
Brian Weiss, to me, the only challenge, the big challenge, actually, that prosecutors sometimes have in cases involving drinking and driving is that a lot of the jurors can have some, you know, introspect and say, yeah, there was a time where I had a few too many. I remember I was driving. Do you think that's an issue here, that some of these jurors may put themselves in the driver's seat of that car and might be a little reluctant to convict someone of murder for drinking, driving, and taking this innocent man's life?
I don't think it's as big an issue as you might think, Vinny, for the simple reason that a skillful prosecutor during jury selection will make sure that anyone who may have any issue with drinking may not be able to serve on this jury, either via a challenge for cause, that is an inability to be fair and impartial, or a peremptory challenge. But again, in Texas, this would not be a murder. This would be an intoxication manslaughter case followed by multiple counts of intoxication assault. You've got to really understand that overcharging is a real problem in the criminal justice system. And to take on an additional burden to prove to this jury in the Commonwealth of Kentucky that this defendant, no matter how much of a chucklehead he might have been that day, knowingly and intentionally caused this man's death, wanting that to happen, I really think may be a bridge too far.
All right, Carmen, you know, from the allegations here, this guy doesn't even have a license, admits drinking the Hennessy, and now we're gonna try to argue that he wasn't intoxicated. Who's gonna drink a bottle of Hennessy and not be intoxicated?
Not many people, but I mean, you know, to Brian's point, maybe that's not going to be a murder here in Texas, but he has six charges. I think they're going to get him on one if they don't get him on all. And in this case, we have a gentleman who, unless the defense proves otherwise or the state can't prove, he's twice the legal limit. Alcohol. He's driving twice the speed limit. He doesn't have a driver's license. And the only thing he can say at arraignment is, I didn't see a stop sign. I don't think that's going to be a good defensive theory going into this trial.
I didn't see a stop sign. I didn't see a golf cart is you know, with all these people in it. That's the other part of it. Gerald, how accurate are blood alcohol readings generally? Because, you know, there are thousands and thousands of DUI cases day after day in courtrooms across America. And some are breathalyzers, some are blood tests. At the end of the day, how much can a defendant attack those results as not being accurate?
Oh, you can absolutely attack it with an expert, especially the breath analyzing machines, the Intoxilizer 5000, the Intoxilizer 9000. You can attack the inner workings of the machine. Many of them are run by a light bulb going through a filter tube that pulls out the supposed alcohol concentration in your deep lungs. It's more efficient and more precise to use blood. So if they use blood in this situation, you need a better expert, but you can definitely attack it, and you can attack the efficacy of the machine any day of the week.
All right, we'll see what the defense does. It all starts tomorrow, folks, right here on your front row seat to justice, gavel to gavel coverage.